In this video, I'll discuss host symptoms and response actions. Before we can determine what behavior is abnormal or suspicious, we've got to know what's normal. At the host level, it's important to establish a normal usage baseline, which we compare current activity against to detect anomalies. Performance degradation, especially over an extended period of time, is an easy indication that we've got some kind of a problem which could even be related to, for instance, compromise or some kind of malware infection. Unexpected configuration changes can also indicate that we've got some kind of a problem, maybe we're infected. For example, the next time you start your web browser, if the home page has been changed to something that you know you did not change it to and you cannot revert it otherwise, you've got some kind of an infection, maybe some kind of spyware or adware that's made the change for you. Either way, it's not good. The same goes for unexpected apps that get installed in the background. Now, in some cases, when users install free software, they just click through the wizard. They click next, 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 without really reading. And sometimes there are additional pieces of software that get installed. However, other times, unbeknown to the user, without their consent, a script or a program can run in the background, and it could result with something being installed that we didn't want installed. Now, in some cases, it can be very difficult to remove that installed app. Now, on a Windows client station, you could revert to a system restore point, an earlier point in time prior to the app being installed, but it's not always quite that basic, especially on the server side or with Linux. With processor consumption, the system will slow down. Users will probably issue or open a help desk ticket quite quickly if this continues. Now, sometimes the culprit could be as simple as a web browser plugin that we didn't install, but rather installed automatically in the background. Web browser plugins give additional functionality for reading PDFs and so on, but you may want to check your web browser plugins or even prevent additional plugins from installing automatically to speed up your web browsing experience. Now, that's specific to a web browser, but it is important. Of course, if we've got some kind of a malware infection, that might show up as processor utilization spiking and maybe even staying spiked for periods of time. Now, what we should do is take a look at our running processes and try to isolate what is causing the processor utilization. Also, sometimes an infected host might be used to send spam email, and that's why outgoing firewall rules on every host should probably carefully look at SMTP traffic leaving the host to verify whether it's legitimate or not. And that's one of the reasons why it's important that every device, including smartphones, have a personal firewall installed and configured appropriately. And those things can be configured centrally. It's not like we have to go to every device and configure the firewall. That's not the case. Also, an infected host might be used as a zombie for a distributed denial of service attack or a DDoS attack. Now, zombie, as you might guess, is an infected machine that's under malicious user control. And a botnet or a zombie net is a collection of these computers. It could be in the dozens, hundreds, even thousands that are under control of a malicious user. And that user can issue some kind of command set to the zombies and have them attack, you know, a victim network or a victim computer and so on. This is another one of those commodities, actually, that gets traded, if you will, on the black market on the internet, along with credit card numbers and PayPal credentials and so on. Once malicious users have these zombie nets under the control, they can actually sell it to others so that others can execute DDoS attacks against victims, maybe in return asking for a ransom payment and so on. Either way, it's all bad stuff. Memory consumption could also be an indication of, well, poor programming. It might require simply a reboot of the system, but it could be a problem with a network attack of some kind. So we might have a remote buffer overflow attack where an attacker is sending more data than the programmer intended for a specific variable in memory. Now, when we overwrite beyond what is allocated in memory, for example, for a variable, the potential exists for us to gain remote administrative privileges to that system, or potentially to corrupt other data beyond what was allocated, thus causing a service or the whole host to crash or malfunction somehow. So we should be monitoring these things: memory, CPU utilization, network traffic, and so on. Storage space consumption is another issue on a host. Now, that could be consumed legitimately by temporary files, but from a malicious standpoint, and we're talking about here being a cybersecurity analyst, an expert in security. The host could have been compromised in the past and is now being used by an attacker to store files. So that could be another reason why we're running out of disk space. It's another one of those aspects of computing that should be monitored periodically. Storage space consumption. Ideally, it would send alerts to administrators when it gets beyond a threshold. Same thing with memory, CPU, and network utilization. Unauthorized software is software that was not installed by the user. So usually the user didn't install it, or if they did intentionally install it, they thought it was something else. It might have looked benign, so it could have been like a Trojan horse piece of software, but really it's malware. Now, in some cases, depending on your systems, it's possible for software to be installed without user consent in the background. In the Windows world, that's precisely what user account control, or UAC, is for. It will prompt the user, well, it depends on the configuration, but it can be configured to prompt the user to allow things to run in the background. The idea is we don't want things installed without user consent. Now, that being said, user account control, UAC, is not designed to replace your malware scanners. You still need those in addition. This just complements it. So unauthorized software, which users might be able to install, and it might actually be what the user wants, but not what the organization wants, this is bad news. We don't want users having the ability to install unauthorized software that isn't approved by the company. That also goes for apps on smartphones, because what happens then is it increases the attack surface. We've got things that aren't necessary, and it just opens up the possibility for more vulnerabilities being exploited by the bad guys. Malicious processes run in the background and usually are a result of some kind of malware infection, and certainly it can degrade system performance. They may also have a corresponding service, or in the case of Linux, a daemon that runs in the background. So we should be monitoring our background services in Windows or daemons in Linux every now and then. What you might want to do is from the command line, get a list of services and pipe it out to a file. Of course, you would automate this. And then periodically, you would compare the current list of running services with what you've piped out to a file. So in Windows, we might do this in PowerShell. In Linux, we might write a shell script to do it. We should always make sure that any processes that should be running, they're allowed to be running, they're legitimate. At the same time, we want to be careful that we don't kill any running processes that we think are nefarious when in fact they are required by the operating system. When you enable auditing, and auditing comes in many forms. You can audit, for example, the failure of logon attempts on a server, or access to delete a file, whether it succeeds or fails, or users creating other user accounts. All that can be audited. So we want to use auditing to detect unauthorized changes. So we want to make sure that we don't bypass the change management control system in place in the company, where we've got a set structure, a formal procedure for making changes. Data exfiltration really deals with data that leaks out of the organization and is thus made available to unauthorized users. Often, this is done without user consent. And again, it could be a result of malware. It could also be a user that intentionally copies sensitive data to removable media, whether or not they intend to provide it to unauthorized users. Again, there are things that we can do to prevent this from happening or to audit this type of activity. In this video, we discussed host symptoms and response actions.